Kept you waiting a little bit. We actually, Dayna scored us a gig in Agora Hills last minute at a wine bar. We had to set up our own PA, and it took us a little bit of time to get out of there. But it put some money in our pocket, which was we were grateful for. And we're grateful that all y'all are here to hear us play some tunes. And we're going to start out with a tune here. Let me check that fiddle. It's a tune called Texas on a Sunday evening. Texas on a Sunday evening. Well, it feels pretty good to me. Margaritas, a taste of southern hospitality. Well, the sun sets big over the hill, and I feel the wind whipping in my ear. Oh, Texas on a Sunday evening, I'll take a Texas any day. But I'll take Topanga Canyon any day. That's right. Tell them again. Songs here. What do you think?
Yeah.
All right. We're on the road from Nashville, Tennessee. We might have neglected to mention that, or maybe you already knew. But we're out for the whole month of October and having a real nice time, but we had our sights set on Topanga, so yeah. We're parked over here at the Malibu RV park. Yeah, we brought an 84 Casita camper. It's turquoise, it's really hip looking. We rented it from our friend, another artist in Nashville, Kevin Daniel, and we're pulling it with our van and having a good old time. These sunsets are unbelievable.
Yeah. Check one.
Muscle Shoals with some of the legends. Cut a record at Fame in 2019 and been back down there since. Dana's been down there doing a lot of session work, and that led me to cutting another record with some of the legends, including David Hood on bass. He's 76 years old when we tracked him. But he was one of the original swampers on all that stuff, Aretha Franklin. But even the later stuff too, like Paul Simon. This is also got an LA cat on the record that I was not familiar with, Ed Green. He's on all the early Barry White records. He's on a Hall & Oates Rich Girl. Great track. He's on Steely Dan Asia. Anyway, real honored to work with these folks. But here's a tune off that. Sometimes I talk too much about the people. I get excited. All right, here we go. We all got brighter days.
Thank you.
found this guitar at a pawn shop in Nashville before we left town for a steal. But I had a friend of mine put a new saddle on it, and so it's been a little finicky. A lot of outdoor gigs. First gig right out of the gate, Bentonville, Arkansas. It was mighty humid, and we were outdoors.
Mighty.
And I was mighty scared that this thing was a bad choice to take on the road, but it's worked out. We got any NPR listeners out there?
Oh, yeah.
I love it. You gotta figure. Well, one day I was listening to NPR and they had an author on there who wrote a book about the woman who is said to have invented the lap dance. And that happened in New Orleans in the early 1900s. And her name was Norma Wallace. The book is called The Last Madam. And so it was just a pretty incredible story. And just so happens they put a transcript of these interviews online, so that was kind of like a, that was it was like a puzzle for me to put together with that interview. There's just, it was a great story. So anyway, I love doing that, like putting something together. So this is the story of Norma. And what was even more inspiring is that I just wrote the song. And then one day I'm sitting at the Jiffy Lube in Nashville, and this girl comes up and she knocks on the window and she goes, hey, are you King Corduroy? And I go, yeah. She goes, did you write a song about Norma Wallace? And I said, yeah, I did. She goes, well, I did too. She said, I'm friends with Christine, the author, and the author had emailed her a link to my song. So the song found its way to
nice.
The author of the book. The universe sent that gal to my window there at the Jiffy Lube to let me know. I thought that was great, you know? So this is the song we call The Queen of New Orleans. She was the queen. Tea. are having fun. Thanks, y'all. You're a great crowd. We're all warmed up. We're just cracking up over here, ain't we? I love it. Well, what should we do for them now? Do you mind?
Are you gonna
do that now? Yeah. This is a song that Dayna recorded down there in Muscle Shoals as well, actually, with said legends. How about the sound in here? Doesn't it sound amazing?
Yes.
Thank you, brother.
That's Hanu. Hanu does
that. Hanu on the sound, y'all. We showed up late. We didn't do anything but just plug in and play. Y'all heard it. That was the sound check. It sounded amazing, right? Golly. Killer lights. The lights are a vibe.
That's Alex.
Yeah. We got video crew here in the front.
That's Orin.
Cheers.
I was probably drinking.
caught that fiddling.
You have.
Yeah, right? Heck yeah. Okay, well, speaking of fiddling, this chair here is about to play its last fiddle.
I feel okay about it.
You feel okay?
It's been like a whole
okay.
time.
Okay, all right. Well, let it be known. I'm a little concerned about it.
Hey.
Yeah.
Like the force.
Just let me know if you need a new one.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's
I can get one.
Structural integrity right here has been compromised. There's one piece missing.
I'm good.
Oh, we're good. She's good. All right. Let's see. What should we do now? Maybe we should sing something together?
Yeah.
Let's do a little something together. There it is. Hell yeah. We're going to play a song that we picked up off of Delaney and Bonnie and Friends record. Right. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah, album called Motel Shot. And, incidentally, there's a new Leon Russell biography that came out. I've been reading it. I don't know if anybody's got it, but a lot of insight into Delaney and Bonnie and Friends. Much insight. A lot about the Palomar Club. Pretty hip. Anywho. I've got a never-ending love for you. From now on, that's all I want to do. From the first time we met, I knew I'd sing my never-ending song for you. I've got a never-ending love for you. Having fun. You gonna play this guitar right here?
Sure.
Yeah, we'll pass it over. Pass it down the line.
What do you want to do?
Try not to get too loud with this amplifier here. See how it goes. Actually, I opened up for the Jerry Garcia tribute band here a handful of times. Jerry's Middle Finger, y'all ever check that out? Great man. Great man. So I know you can get down in this club because I've witnessed those shows.
Oh, yeah.
Everything goes here. he's the gig some with the keyboard player from that band. John Green? Nobody's keeping score. It's making a little noise, that's why I put it on standby. It's a little noisy.
Alright. That's the way it's gonna be. Shall we? Oh, yeah.
We're gonna do another one like this while we got it all figured out here.
Same key, just different, totally different vibe.
Yeah.
Yep. Yes, ma'am.
Apologize for my amplifier being, it was inappropriately loud.
No,
I was
good.
All in. It was way back there.
Great.
Thanks, y'all. Thank you. Yeah, immediately. I was like, golly, this is pretty loud.
It was quite loud.
Yeah.
Next time I want it louder.
That's a deal.
Alrighty.
These amps go to 12. It's on like underneath 2 right now over there. They're a bit loud. In Spinal Tap, they go to 11, but in Fender World, they go to 12. All right, so what should we do now? We're going to get them working for a living?
Sure.
Here, give you a song off that record. Already played a couple off of it, but here's that record we cut at Fame Studio. Also, we'll take this time to mention we got some merch over here, some t-shirts and CDs, some floaties for your boat keys, or if you're a surfer, or if you're in on the 405 and you're feeling stressed, they work too. I always count this song in, but I play the pickup, so I'm just counting in for myself if it's a duo. It's pretty funny. I count it in and then I play by myself. Anyway. I put my working gloves on. It's been a long time coming. I've been a long time gone. Guess I'll come back when I'm ready. But I don't know when that'll be. So I'll keep working for a living. I keep on trimming all these leaves. Working for a living. I'm just trying to find a way. Searching for answers to questions I can't escape. Working for a living. I'm just trying to find a way. And take it back to Tennessee. Into the trees, it's been giving me perspective, keeping my mind at ease. There'll be no more second guessing, got no more tricks up my sleeve. Out here in Paris, California, all these leaves. Working for a living. I'm just trying to find a way. Searching for answers to questions I can't escape. It's our only guarantee.
Bravo.
All right, thanks, y'all. Okay, so over the pandemic, we started watching a YouTube channel. This fella, well, y'all ever heard of this Ghost Town Living? Has anybody ever watched that? There's a ghost town. It's Cerro Gordo, California. It's in Desert Valley. It's above Owens Lake, which is the lake in, if y'all remember, Chinatown, where they're stealing the water. Well, that lake is like about dried up now. And there's a mine up above it. Yeah. Lone Pine is the nearest town. But anyway, like I said earlier, I like to like kind of take a puzzle, you know, and put it together for a song. So there's a lot of history I can look up on this town. And so I wrote a song, and I took some stuff from the guy's experience there. His name is Brent Underwood. One day he just goes in these abandoned mines, like by himself with his phone, you know, and just films. Oh, he's out there all alone, and he's built a community, and he has millions of followers. But one day he was digging in a mine, and he said that somebody had told him, it's not what you find, it's what you find out. And I was like, damn, that's brilliant. So put that in the hook of the song and sent it to him, and he made a video for it. It was really cool. And So we told him we want to come play a concert in Cerro Gordo. Dana's like, you need to reach out to him again. He said okay on Instagram, y'all. We were in a direct message, but we're going to drive to Cerro Gordo tomorrow.
If we hear back from him.
We heard back from him. He's not the most punctual person with his responses, but...
You gotta go, right?
So anyway, here's the song. This is Cerro Gordo. We played it on the tour right there. That was fun.
It was lovely.
Thank you. Thank you. It's a lot of words. Once I can't remember, and she mouths the first line to me so I can remember. was like, yeah, there was another great line in there. There was a LA Times article, and it said, this is from the late 1800s, it said that Cerro Gordo wove the silver cord to bind Los Angeles. They were bringing it all down to downtown Los Angeles, but I thought that was beautiful line, to put that there in the song as well. The silver cord to bind Los Angeles. Love that. Okay, what should we do now? Oh, okay, yeah. So, used to live here in Los Angeles. We both have done our Los Angeles time, not together, but we met and fell in love in Nashville and have shared our love for Los Angeles. We keep coming back every year, and did live in Topanga for a while, also lived in Hollywood, lived in a lot of vehicles, parked an RV in front of this fella's house that I met at the piano bar, and his name's Jimmy, and he looks like me if you aged me like 40 years and shrunk me down a little bit. Anytime we went somewhere, people would ask if he was my grandfather, told me he was my cosmic grandfather. Jimmy had a 61 Cadillac sedan DeVille that he let me drive, and he was very generous, too generous, and he let all these people move into his house, and they were kind of taking advantage of him, and Jimmy got overwhelmed by the financial housing crisis when the market hit. He actually was owned four homes on Lexington Avenue in Hollywood, like right down from the police department. And he had four homes, and he had rented a house to park his vehicles because he had that Cadillac. He also had a limo that he sold. He also had like a 72 Chevy pickup. Anyway, he had some groovy cars, you know? So he rented a house just to park these vehicles. But then when he lost it all because he was in construction, he was building homes. So he lost his work, he lost his houses, then he moved into that rental house. And he was there in that rental house he was on the street for 35 years in different homes. But I was telling him, because the house he was living in that he did not own was going up for sale, because all the land, y'all know, is worth so much more than some of these old houses. And so I was trying to encourage Jimmy to just go back to Iowa, because he had family there. And so I was writing this song at his house, and he wound up, he drove back, and he took 7 feral cats from Hollywood with him to Iowa. He had them all in kennels. He had one in his lap, Dolly in his lap. And they made it all the way, and we've gone and visited him in Iowa, and he's doing well. And this is a song I wrote for him. This is called Jimmy's Song.
Are the cats doing okay?
Man, I was like, should I say or should I not say? They've all passed now, but they do have... Yeah, but there's some Dolly offspring that live. But yeah, I asked him how they like it. He's like, I don't know. I think sometimes they were mad at me because I took them to the snow. But he had a big setup where they could roam, and they did venture into the snow. You know, I was just thinking, the first time I ever played this song when I was writing it, y'all remember the 1-3-1 over here?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the first time I ever played this was at 1-3-1. Even think about that. How about that? Okay, so here we go.
Oh,
see Jimmy, that just wasn't right.
On standby.
Oh,
empty room. Where'd you go, honey? Why'd you leave so soon?
I know what song I want to do now. I've got another storytelling song for you. I worked for 5 seasons as a trimmigrant. And when I tell people about this in the South, it's a little more of a foreign idea to them. Most of y'all probably heard the term, maybe not, but going up to Northern California to work to trim grass, and it's quite an experience because in this little town, Arcata, there's a plaza by Humboldt State University, which is in the Redwoods. It's beautiful. And people go to this plaza in Arcata from all over the world, not knowing anyone, but just knowing that there's work to find there. And you never know where you might find yourself. And there's good farms and bad farms. And I found myself on a lot of good ones, but one that was a little bit sketchy for sure, all the way up in Shasta, California. But the fellow I worked for told me a lot of crazy stories, so I started writing them down. He said it was okay to write this song. So this is the story of Einstein. Well, I was born in the hills of Mount Shasta, a little town called Blue Lake. I did some time in Susanville, graduated from Pelican Bay. You know, I shoveled snow in the dark to make the morning call. With 23 men to a sail, you had to sleep with your shoes on. Some people don't know about an honest day's pay. Oh, Eureka, Arcata, McKinleyville, Blue Lake. I worked them all to see what I could raise. And I know the rules, if you know what I mean. Do you know what I mean? When all this comes, I'm gonna be living like a king. Until then, I got the Emerald Triangle Blues. Tell about it. Score the next hit, and I buried him right there in Fortuna with a 6-pack and some seeds, cause I wanted something to grow. I was 22, the year was 1993, yeah. You know they call me Einstein, cause we're starting the trade, got camps in the fires, crouching underneath chopper blades, and the Emerald Triangle. But baby, we ain't got it made. You know my people cook some hot shots. Oh, I believe I seen the devil's face. Right there, Eureka, Arcata, McKinleyville, Blue Lake. I worked them all to see what I could raise. Until then, I got the Emerald Triangle Blues.
Yeah.
All right. Well, shit. Maybe do one more and call it. What do you think? Y'all a great crowd. Appreciate y'all hanging out. Appreciate friends hanging out.
Hey, you deserve a lot more.
Yeah, you know, should we do more than just one?
No, I'm saying, there should be so much more crowd.
Well, you're kind. You know what? With time.
Time's on your side.
That's right. Well, I'm going to tell you what. So we got Dayna works for the Society of Lyricists and Composers. Composers and lyricists. I shouldn't be telling you, she should be telling
you. I don't know what you're about to say.
Well, today, I got invited to a screening at Netflix, and it was a movie that was very inspiring. That's why I thought about it. But it was about a woman who swam from Cuba to
Key West.
It took her 60 days, 50-some days. Yeah, and she was like 62 years old. It took her 5 tries, and she finally... I shouldn't tell them that she... Well, it's common knowledge that she did it. Anyway,
yeah,
the movie's really good.
It's common.
You know about it.
A lady who swam the English Channel as well.
Yeah, so I'm an expert now that I've seen the movie, obviously. But apparently the English Channel is 20 miles. And this was like... She wound up swimming 110 miles because
crazy.
She had to fight the current.
Yeah, that's...
Anyway, it was inspiring. I found myself unloading my amplifier, and I was like, oh, my back hurts. And I was like, whoa, no. What was her last name?
She went by Naiad.
Naiad, that's her last name. Yeah, Naiad. It was like, if Naiad can swim from Cuba to Florida at the age of like 63, I can handle the amp. It's fine. I'll do it. Anyway, all right. What are we going to do? Oh, yes. We want to give you one final song here. It's a Buck Owens song. Baker's Fields Own. It doesn't sound right, but it is. That's right. Well, it's crying time again. You're gonna leave me. I can see that faraway look in your eye. I can tell by the way you hold me, darling, that it won't be long before it's crying time. See the absence makes the heart go fonder. Then tears only rain bitter grow. Well, for you, my love could grow no stronger if I live.
I can see that far.
back next year, if not sooner.